सीसीएसई इंग्लिश इट ऑल्सो प्रोवाइड्स कोचिंग फॉर स्टेट पीएससी एग्जाम्स एसएससी सीजीएल एग्जाम एंड ऑल्सो क्लैट एग्जाम्स एंड अबाउट मी आई एम संदीप भूषण थुमला एंड माई क्रेडेंशियल्स आर I have 10 years of teaching experience for civil services. I teach international relations and internal security and also the analysis of the Hindu newspaper. And my session, that is today's class, will definitely help you to crack prelims and mains examinations because I would be emphasizing on the keywords and the key phrases from the newspaper wherein while emphasizing on the keywords and the key phrases, I will make you understand how we can try to arrive at the factual, analytical, and also conceptual questions. And also conceptual questions for the prelims point of view. So definitely it will be useful for the prelims examinations. And I will make you understand how you need to inculcate or what is the importance of imbibing the keywords and the key phrases in the answer writing. So definitely it will be useful even for the mains examinations wherein you would be writing the answers, which your answers have to be precise and concise. Once your answers are precise and concise, which is actually demanding by the UPSC or the State Public Service Commissions, thereby your answers would be precise and concise. Once you get into the habit of imbibing the keywords and the key phrases in your answer writing, that is in the mains examination. So thereby you will also be benefited in the mains examination by scoring higher marks by imbibing the keywords and the key phrases. So therefore my entire session will help you to crack prelims and mains both for 2020 as well as 2021. And today's session is in regards to the daily news analysis, which is today's, that is 22nd of July 2020. And here I would re-emphasize and reiterate my tagline, that is Sandeep Bhushan tagline, that is emphasizing on the keywords and the key phrases, which will be very, very useful for the prelims as well as mains examinations. And it will also be a very important for even the interview also. So before I get into the topic, I would say very good morning to everyone who is in the live chat and also in the live. So very good morning to Rahul, Nandita, Prithviraj, Sohail, Sushma Reddy, Praveen Kumar, and then David Paul, Ashwini Ravi Kumar, Rachel Sneha, all of you very good morning. And I would get into the topic, that is the daily news analysis. And before that, there is a quote of the day, quote of the day. So what is the quote of the day? The secret to getting ahead. So you need to move ahead, that is reach your goals. And for that, what is important is you need to get started. So whenever you wanted to reach your goals, the secret to getting ahead in the sense, you have to move forward, ahead in the sense, move forward. So when you want to reach your goals, what is important is you need to start working for it. So the quote of the day is, the secret to getting ahead or secret of getting ahead is getting started. So this is a quote of the day which will really motivate you in regards to reaching your goal. So to reach your goal, what is very important is you need to start, and that is very, very important. And before I get into the topic, that is daily news analysis, Gopi Nayak has joined, Ravi, Mani Kumar, Harawat Manohar, all of you very good morning. Now I'll get into the topic, that is which talks about relief for Sachin Poylet camp as High Court holds off verdict till July 24th. And here I'm making it very clear that we are not at all worried about or we will not enter into what is happening between the Congress or the BJP which is trying to, or whatever the telephone calls, all that we will not enter into that because it is all politics. So politically we will not enter into that, but we will enter or we will look at this or we will analyze this news. We will analyze this news, that is the High Court which has hold of the verdict till July 24th. That is for the Sachin Pilot camp along with a Sachin Pilot 1+18. That is total for 19 MLAs. So 19 MLAs were actually by the speaker, they were disqualified. They were the speaker has taken a decision to disqualify the 19 dissident MLAs, that is from the Congress or the Congress, rebel Congress MLAs. So we will look at from the competitive exam point of view or UPSC exam point of view or Public Service Commission exam point of view or State Public Service Commission exam point of view only. We will not get into the any kind of political debate, right? So yeah, what is important is when the speaker has given the disqualification notice to Sachin Pilot and the other 18 MLAs. So they have approached. So Sachin Pilot camp, that is 18+1, 19 MLAs have approached the Rajasthan High Court. They have approached the Rajasthan High Court in regards to the decision taken by the Speaker of the Rajasthan. Who is the Speaker of the Rajasthan? C.P. Joshi. Speaker of the Rajasthan is C.P. Joshi. So the Speaker has given a disqualification notices to the Sachin Pilot and the other 18 MLAs. And in fact, later on, the Sachin Pilot camp, that is 19 MLAs, have approached the Rajasthan High Court. And what is the decision taken by the Rajasthan High Court is the judge, that is two judge bench of Rajasthan High Court, has reserved, this is very important, has reserved, this keyword is very important, it has reserved the verdict. So it did not give any kind of verdict or judgment or any kind of statement, but it has reserved. That means it has kept it 2 years itself. Then it said that it will keep it to reserve or it will keep it to itself until July 24. Please do understand, until July 24. So what is important here is the speaker's decision in regards to the disqualification of the MLAs. And later on, MLAs approaching the Rajasthan High Court, and the Rajasthan High Court, that is the two-judge bench, has reserved the case which the Sachin Pilot camp has approached the Rajasthan High Court. So definitely, the court has given 4-day reprieve. Reprieve in the sense, some time, 4-day time for the Sachin Pilot camp from any action to be taken by the speaker. So definitely what the speaker was actually given has the power. Here the power of the speaker is to disqualify the MLAs, that is 19 MLAs. But they have approached the Rajasthan High Court, and Rajasthan High Court has reserved the verdict. They haven't given any judgment, but they have reserved, they have kept it for themselves, and they said that they will take the decision on July 24th. So that means the Rajasthan Division Bench or two judge division bench of Rajasthan has made it very clear that the Sachin Pilot camp should not be taken any action by the speaker until July 24. This is very important. So the speaker cannot take any action, that is in regards to the disqualifying the 19 MLAs, until or up to July 24. This is important. Up to July 24. Why? The Rajasthan High Court has reserved this verdict, and it has said that the Pilot camp or the Sachin Pilot, that is 19 MLAs, should not be taken any action by the speaker until July 24. So what is important for here, for us, for competitive exam point of view, the role or the powers of the speaker and what the Rajasthan High Court has said to the speaker not to take any action. Not to take any action further until July 24. Not completely, but till July 24. The Speaker of the Rajasthan is C.P. Joshi. And Sridevi has joined, Gopi Kiran has joined, Manjula, Pavan Kumar, Masterminds, Ram Kumar, Prithviraj, everyone have joined. Very good morning to you all. And then before I get into the topic, Prithviraj has written, is asking that if those MLAs are disqualified, will those MLAs seats will be re-elected by by-elections? Yes, within 6 months, they have to. Within 6 months, Prithvi, they have to go for the elections within 6 months. And now what is important is the Congress party is exploring the options for review petition. Again, why we are talking about Congress party is the keyword here. What is the keyword here? That is review petition. So this is a keyword here. So now the Congress party is trying to file a petition for review, to file a petition in the High Court or in the Supreme Court later on. First it will be in the Rajasthan High Court to file a petition. What kind of petition? It is a review. Review to what? Review to what the Rajasthan High Court has said, that till July 24, the Speaker should not take any action against the 19 MLAs. Up to July 24, the Rajasthan High Court has said the Speaker should not take any action against the 19 MLAs. For that, the Congress party is exploring options to file a review petition in the Rajasthan High Court. So what is important here? The Congress party or political party is not really important. The review petition is important for us for the prelims point of view. Review petition. And the party has raised concerns over the direction that encroach. So here again, what is the other keyword what we need to focus is the High Court. What the party is saying is the Rajasthan High Court, the court is encroaching. The court is encroaching on the speaker's power. Please do understand, these are all very, very important for prelims as well as mains examinations. So the party, the Congress party, is saying that the Rajasthan High Court, by saying that until or else up to July 24th, the speaker should not take any action against the 19 MLAs. By that, what the party is saying is that the direction given by the Rajasthan High Court is encroaching on the speaker's power. Encroaching in the sense, trying to take over, because who has the supreme power in regards to the disqualification of the MLAs? That is the discretionary power of the speaker. It is the discretionary power of the speaker to disqualify the MLAs. That is the speaker's discretionary power. So that discretionary powers, what the party is saying is that the direction given by this Rajasthan High Court is encroaching on the speaker's power. And there is another application of petition filed by an NGO called as Public Against Corruption, PAC, Public Against Corruption. And there also the court has also looked into the matter in regards to the anti-defection law, which is under 10th schedule of the Indian Constitution. So what is important for us in regards to the prelims point of view or mains point of view is the speaker's discretionary powers, the Rajasthan High Court direction to the speaker. Rajasthan's High Court direction to the speaker is the keyword here, please do understand. And the anti-defection law of the 10th schedule of the Indian Constitution. So all these anti-defection law, 10th schedule, discretionary powers of the speaker, and then Rajasthan High Court directing the speaker not to take action against the MLAs to disqualify them. So these are the keywords for the prelims point of view. Apart from that, politically we will not interfere. We are not also worried about it. And Devika says, very good morning, namaste, very good morning to you. Chandrasekhar, very good morning. Rahul is asking question, does High Court has a power to stop speaker to utilize his power? Yes, definitely, we will look into it. So as I was saying, that speaker has, or it is the discretionary power of the speaker in regards to the disqualification, in regards to the disqualifying the MLAs. On what grounds, or on which grounds the speaker will disqualify the MLAs is the discretionary power of the speaker. But most of the time we have seen the speaker is taking advantage of the discretionary powers of the speaker. And here the High Court and the Supreme Court is intervening in the sense it is interfering. As Rahul is asking, can the High Court interfere in the Supreme Court in the Speaker's power to disqualify the MLAs? Can the High Court here in this case, the Rajasthan High Court, can it interfere in the Speaker's MLA powers or Speaker's discretionary power to disqualify the MLAs? Okay, what is the reason for disqualifying of the MLAs is because the 19 MLAs, they are actually Congress party. They are Congress party MLAs. What they have done is they wanted to move out of the Congress party. They wanted to split, or they wanted to move away from the Congress party itself. And when they move away from the Congress party, what will happen is, if suppose they are not disqualified, so they can vote in the no confidence motion, no confidence motion in the house, or in regards to the floor test. So when the 19 MLAs, Congress party MLAs, are moving away from the Congress party itself, INC, Indian National Congress Party in the Rajasthan, so when the number comes down, when the number comes down, the MLA number comes down in the house of the Rajasthan, so the Congress party, the party or the government of the day, has to prove its majority by no confidence motion or the floor test. So in that case, the Congress party or the Indian National Congress will not have the required strength to prove its majority as the no confidence motion or the floor test, that they can form the government or they can run the government. So in that case, the Speaker will disqualify. When the Speaker disqualifies these 19 MLAs, then the number required in the no confidence motion also will reduce, and thereby the Congress party, thereby the Indian National Congress party in Rajasthan can, what you say, pass the no confidence motion or the floor test. That is why the Speaker has taken the decision. I think Nandita has got the point. Sushma Reddy, okay, which third point? Okay, I did. Anti-defection 10th schedule. Okay, I will explain. Don't worry about it. So I think even Rahul has got the answer. Rahul has got the answer. And in regards to the High Court and the Supreme Court intervening, is as per Article 142 of the Indian Constitution. As per Article 142 of the Indian Constitution, the High Court can take a decision in regards to the functioning of the government. That is, the government has to function. The government cannot be in a animated state, or it cannot be saying that it will not, but they have to prove the majority and the government has to function. For that, the High Court and the Supreme Court has the power to intervene in regards to the speakers of the discretionary powers of the speaker. It could be legislative assembly or parliament, that is Lok Sabha, as per Article 142, the Supreme Court has it. So now we will look at, okay, Gopi Nayak says that last year, yes, definitely if we look at Karnataka has taken into that, and then we have seen again Meghalaya, again we have seen in Madhya Pradesh recently, and now Rajasthan. And then we have seen, what do you say, this discretionary powers, even in Telangana also we have seen last term, we have seen almost Telugu Desam party leaders and party MLAs and then the Congress MLAs who have shifted stance to the government. So the Speaker hasn't taken the decision. So it was the discretionary powers. And once the MLAs, that is total 2/3 of the MLAs, have joined the government, that is the Telangana government, then what has happened is, that is merger of the party takes place. That I will explain in the 10th schedule. So what is important, and this is an additional information which is not in the newspaper, but additional information I am giving it for the prelims polity. Decision can be changed, but the High Court and the Supreme Court can direct the Speaker to go ahead with taking the action very fast. Rahul, the high, yeah, Madhya Pradesh recently. Yes, David Paul, very well said. What the High Court and the Supreme Court can say is, it can direct the speaker to take the action very fast, or in regards to the year in this case, to give the 19 MLAs time till July 24th. That is what it is, and it can. And as per this, this is additional information, and the 10th schedule was inserted in the constitution in 1985. This is very important, and it is popularly known as anti-defection law, and it is known as anti-defection law, and it has been 1985, the 10th schedule is being introduced in the constitution or inserted in the year 1985, and it is popularly known as anti-defection law, and it has been inserted in the constitution in the year 1985 by which amendment? 52nd Amendment Act. This is very important for prelims point of view. 52nd Amendment Act. And what does this anti-defection law lays down? It lays down the process. Process for what? Disqualification. Please do understand, the 10th schedule or the anti-defection law, which was introduced in 1985 by the 52nd Amendment Act, lays down the process. Process for what? Process for what? Process for disqualification of the MLAs, on the grounds of defection. Defection is moving from one political party to another political party, defecting one political party to and getting into another political party. And who lays the process for disqualification? It is the presiding officer. Who is the presiding officer here? The Speaker of the House. The Speaker of the House is the presiding officer. Speaker of the House is the presiding officer. So the process to disqualify will be taken up by the presiding officers on the grounds of defection. On the grounds of defection, and which is based on the petition by any other member of the House. So it can be process. The process of disqualification can be taken up by the presiding officer on the basis of defection, which can be actually taken up by when there is a petition which has been brought to the notice to the speaker by any other member of the House. So one is petition. How the speaker process can be taken up to disqualify? That is in regards to the, if there is any petition by any member to disqualify the member of the House who has defected from one political party to another political party. And not only that, whenever an MLA or a legislator is defecting or voluntarily is moving away or voluntarily is shifting his stance from one political to another political party, please do understand, one is in regards to the petition, when there is petition filed by any other member of the House, or when the MLA himself is voluntarily giving up the membership of the political party from which he has been elected, and then he is moving away from to another political party. Or when a legislator, that is MLA, is defying means what? Abstaining or voting against. This is what will happen. Now this is what will happen in Rajasthan. Rajasthan Assembly. When Ashok Gehlot government will be forced to prove the majority floor test. When they are forced to prove the majority, no confidence motion or the floor test, what will happen is, these 19 MLAs whom the speaker has given the notice for the disqualification, they might vote against. That is why now itself the speaker has given the notice to disqualify them, or they are going against the party whip. That is the directions given by the party, wherein they are going against the direction of the political party. So these 19 MLAs are actually who? They are being elected from the Congress or INC, Indian National Congress. So they are there, but when the voting takes place, they might vote against the Ashok Gehlot government. And then there is a possibility that the Ashok Gehlot government might not prove the confidence motion in the House, and then they might fail to prove the majority on the floor of the House. That is why the speaker can go ahead with process. So what are the three areas with the process can be taken up, that is whenever process to disqualify the legislator, disqualify the legislator, that is whenever a petition is filed or there is voluntarily the MLA shifting his stand from to another political party, or when MLAs or the legislators are voting against, defying is voting against the whip which has been issued by the party, ruling government party. So this is very very important for prelims point of view about 10th schedule. And the disqualification, the grounds of disqualification is actually mentioned in the 10th schedule, we said, but it is mentioned in the paragraph 2 of the 10th schedule. This is important. There could be a question in the prelims, in which among the following paragraph or in which among the following paragraph of the 10th schedule the grounds for disqualification are mentioned. So it is mentioned in the paragraph 2 of the 10th schedule. And in regards to this, article 101, 102, 190 and 191 were amended for what? For the grounds of disqualification. Rahul says, not only in this case. Yes, definitely. Whenever, that is what I am saying. I said, Rahul, whenever the functioning of the government or government is not functioning, government is not functioning because of the instability or because of the infighting. So in that case, the High Court or the Supreme Court can interfere. And we have seen in many cases, we have seen in recent Madhya Pradesh, in Karnataka also we have seen it in Meghalaya also. That is what I am saying. So High Court and Supreme Court can intervene, and that is as per Article 142, I said. And case of the merger, so the 10th schedule talks about, which has said that whenever a party wanted, there will not be any disqualification to the MLAs. There will not be any disqualification to the MLAs when the MLAs, no disqualification to the MLAs will happen when the MLAs are totally one third of them shift their party to the another party, that is in the case of merger. So whenever they are shifting individually, if they are shifting, yes, disqualification can take place. But when they are shifting, that entire one third of the MLAs are shifting their to another political party, that is not just shifting but merger of political party. So here in this case, the 19 MLAs cannot merge because they are not the one, because the Chief Minister is there, Ashok Gehlot is there, who is from the Indian National Congress. So the 19 MLAs cannot claim that they are the party, that is they are the Indian National Congress party here in this case. Fine. And this one third was changed because there was a situation wherein many of the political parties were directly shifting. One third was very easy for them to bring or to woo the MLAs, and then one third of them shift the stand, and then they say, because this happens wherever there is the total number of the strength of the assembly is very less, somewhere around 60 or 40, especially in the smaller states, and then smaller states, especially in the northeastern states, wherever the total number of MLAs of the house or the assembly is 60 or 40, in that case one third can be very easily shifted. So later on, what has happened is this one third has been changed in the year 2003 by the 91st Amendment Act, and this one third was later on increased to two third of the party legislators. So one third was very easy to shift, the shift or merger can take place, but later on it was shifted to two third. But what is happening is even now two third has become very easy to shift from one political party to another political party, that is merger of the political party itself. So in regards to the prelims point of view, what is important is the 10th schedule, The anti-defection law, 52nd amendment, 1985. The presiding officers voluntarily moving away, the legislator moving away or defecting from one political party to another political party whenever it disobeys or defies, that is voting against the government, or else the grounds of disqualification, merger, one third, and then later on 91st Amendment Act 2003, which has increased to two third. And Gopi Nayak is asking why 19 MLAs are against their governments. Okay, here in this case Rajasthan, 19 MLAs are not really happy with the way the Ashok Gehlot government is actually going ahead, and they wanted to move away. And then even in this case there are few demands from the Sachin Poilet. So who is Sachin Poilet here? He was the deputy CM. Deputy CM of Rajasthan, and he was the Pradesh Congress Committee, PCC chief. He was a PCC chief. So along with him, 18 Congress MLAs have come out. Fine? Okay, fine. Thank you. Srujan has joined. Very good morning to Srujan. So here in this case, what is important, we did not really focus on the political instability or political matter, but what is important for UPSC or State Public Service Commission in regards to polity, we have discussed. And there is one more news which talks about president urged to stall capital bills. So again, the keyword here is the president is coming. So there, in the first case, that was the High Court, was the High Court was so in the first case when we are talking about Rajasthan, it was High Court was the keyword from there, keyword, and here the president is the keyword. What is the news here? Because the Narsapur MP, that is from Andhra Pradesh, from AP, Narsapuram MP, that is K Raghu Ramakrishna Raju. So Narsapuram MP K Raghu Ramakrishna Raju has asked the President of India, that is Ramnath Kovind's intervention. He is asking the MP, Narsapuram MP of Andhra Pradesh, from Andhra Pradesh, that is K Raghu Ramakrishna Raju, is asking the President of India, that is Ramnath Kovind's intervention. Why? Because he wanted president to stall in the sense to stop. So the MP of Narsapuram, that is K Raghu Ramakrishna Raju, is asking the president of India to stall in the sense to stop. What to stop? He wants to stop the bills which have been passed by the AP Legislative Assembly. Please do understand here, which had been passed by the AP Legislative Assemblies or Andhra Pradesh Legislative Assembly, which had been passed. So what are the two bills is very important for the State Public Service Commission and also for the UPSC, because he has sought the president intervention, that is Ramnath Kovind's. Why? Because he says that the bills which have been passed, two bills were been passed by the AP Legislative Assembly, that two bills and development authority, CRDA. So he is asking these two bills to be repealed. What do you mean by repeal? Repeal means cancel. So look at it. Again, we are just focusing on polity. We are not focusing on political scenario in the Andhra Pradesh. No, we are focusing on the polity, which is useful for the prelims point of view. So the president is there here, and then MP, member of parliament, asking the president to stall or to repeal the two bills which have been passed by the Andhra Pradesh Legislative Assembly. That is, one is inclusive development of all regions, and the second one is CRDA, that is Capital Region Development Authority. So why he is saying it has to be stalled? Because Raghu Ramakrishna Raju says that these two bills which have been passed in the Andhra Pradesh are unconstitutional and anti-public. So these two keywords, please do take it into consideration. So he says they are unconstitutional. The passage of the bills two bills, that is IDAR and CRDA, are unconstitutional and anti-public. It is his view, his personal view. And then he also is making it very clear that as this matter, as a matter, which matter is that? In regards to the inclusive development of all regions and then Capital Region Development Authority is in the High Court. Is in the High Court, AP High Court. So as it is in the AP High Court, as the matter is still pending in the High Court, so deciding on the constitutional questions is what you say mandatory to refer the bills to the president. This is very, very important point. What the MP Raghu Ramakrishna Raju has put forward the matter, that when the matter is pending, that is CRDA and the IDAR, that bills which have been passed, that actually those matters are pending in the High Court. And when it is pending in the High Court, those questions, that is the questions which are pending, that is constitutional questions which are pending in the High Court, has to be mandatorily referred the bills to the president. So you look at it from a polity point of view, how it is very important. So he says that those bills which are pending in the High Court, which are constitutional questions, has to be mandatorily referred to the president. Those bills have to be referred to the president. As per what? As per Article 200. This is very, very important for prelims point of view. So here Raghu Ramakrishna Raju has said that you intervene, has requested the Ramnath Kovind, the president of India, to stall or repeal the bills wherein the bills have been passed by the AP Legislative Assembly, and those bills which have been passed by the AP Legislative Assembly are pending. Those matters are pending in the High Court, and when they are pending in the High Court, what he says, that is the MP says, is it is mandatory that those bills should be referred to the president under the Article 200. This is very, very important. Under Article 200 of Indian Constitution. So we are not looking at the political game plan. No, we are just looking at the polity, Article 200. And he has also urged the president to take the opinion of Attorney General. Fine. And he has also alleged the state government, that is the Andhra Pradesh state government, that there has to be more of discussion, or there was misinterpretation against or of Article 197. So there are two articles which you need to focus here, is Article 200 and Article 197, which is very, very important for prelims, both for UPSC and also for State Public Service Commission, whoever is giving the exam for, in regards to especially AP and Telangana, they can go ahead with this. This is very, very important. And then before I get into the Article 200, Anji has joined. Very good morning to you. And this about Article 200 is an additional information which I am giving for you for the prelims point of view, polity prelims point of view. It is not in the newspaper. Just till here it is in the newspaper. That is, there is mention about Article 200, there is mention of Article 97, that is, and repeal of the bills which has to be referred to the president. Only till there it is there. But the what is Article 200, there is no mention. And this is an additional information which I am providing, extra information for you all for a better understanding, so that you can score more marks in the prelims and mains examination. And Harika has also joined. Very good morning to you, Harika. And what does this Article 200 of the Indian Constitution deals with? So it deals with the governor. Please do understand. Article 200 deals with the powers of the governor. Powers of the governor. Why? Whether to regard, in regards to the assent. Assent in the sense giving permission, authorization, permission to the bills which have been passed by the state legislature, that is from the by the state legislature or state assembly. So whenever a state assembly passes a bill, so that bill can be actually stopped by the powers of the governor as per Article 200. For how that can be stopped? By reserving the bill for the president consideration. So what the governor can do here is, the governor which actually he has got the bill which has been passed by the state assembly, the governor in turn can, what do you say, reserve the bill, can keep it to himself, reserve the bill, saying that he is actually reserving the bill for the president's consideration. Please do understand. So this is very important. So whenever a bill is been passed by the state legislative assembly, and which is again later on shifted, or which is again for the assent, that is for the sign of the governor, so there the governor can give the assent, or he can reserve the bill, he can give the assent, or he can reserve the bill. So here in this case, as per article 200, the governor can reserve the bill. Why? Bill for the president's consideration, and as per article 200, the governor has four options. One is, he can sign the bill, he can withhold the bill, that is he can keep it to himself, reserve the bill. Yes, withhold in the sense here, he will not give any explanation to the state assembly. He can reserve the bill, saying that he is considering the opinion of the president, or he can return the bill to the legislature for reconsideration. That means the governor says that no, these are the points which are not really necessary, or you have to go ahead with the changes or the amendments in the bill. So thereby again the state legislature will go ahead with changing of the bill and will again pass it to the, or send it to the governor for the assent, for the signature. So one is, he can assent the bill, he can withhold the bill, he can reserve the bill, he can return the bill to the state legislative assembly. Reserve for the president consideration. So these are very, very important for the prelims point of view. Article 200, the powers of the governor. Azmat Khan has joined, very good morning. Rajshekhar has joined, very good morning. So article 200 is an additional information which is again very important for prelims point of view. Four options, please do understand these four options: assent, withhold, reserve, return. And he has also mentioned about, see, look at here, he said the Ramakrishna Raju MP, Narsapuram MP, said that the state government was making a deliberate misinterpretation of clauses of the article 197. So we will look at what is article 197 for the prelims point of view. Again, this is an additional information which I am giving, which is not in the newspaper, but it is an additional information. So what is article 197? So article 197 gives the powers to the legislative council, so council means MLC, upper house. It gives, article 197 gives the powers of legislative councils as to bills or other than money bills. So it gives the restriction. What powers it gives? It gives the powers to the legislative council to restrict, to stop. Please do understand. This is very, very important. Very, very important for the prelims polity point of view. Article 197 of the Indian Constitution gives the legislative council the powers to restrict. Restrict what? Restrict the bills. But bills other than money bill. Because money bill will be introduced only in the legislative council or Rajya Sabha. Please do understand. Money bill. Why? Restrictions cannot be done to other than money bill, it said. Because money bill cannot be restricted. Why? Because money bill will be initiated in the legislative council itself. As it is initiated in the legislative council, the legislative council cannot or do not have the power to restrict the money bill, because it is the one which is actually initiating the money bill. So when it has the power to initiate, it doesn't have the power to restrict it, as in the case of legislative council, as also in the case of Rajya Sabha. So the money bill can be initiated or introduced in the legislative council, in the state assemblies, or in the state, not assembly, state, and in the center, that is in the Rajya Sabha. So money bill, again here the keyword is money bill. So article 197 gives a restriction in regards to the powers to the legislative council to restrict any other bill, any bill it can restrict other than money bill. So money bill cannot be restricted. So that is what Ramakrishna Raju MP is saying, that the state government has misinterpreted the article 197. Ramakrishna Raju has said that state government, AP state government, has misinterpreted the article 197, and that is what the article 197 gives the powers to restrict the it gives the power for the legislative council to restrict the bills other than money bills. Now we will look at little bit in depth of it, which will be very, very important for you. Actually, I can just say this point and I can stop it, but for your benefit I am saying the extra one, which I will just tell it in a very, what you say, concise manner. And when a bill, see, now the state legislature here in this case, that is AP, here in this case AP state legislature has passed the bill, that is both the bills, that is the CRDA and then the other one IDRA. So both the bills it has been passed. So when it has been passed by the assembly and it has sent to the legislative council, so what the legislative council can do, when it has passed, the state legislature has passed and it has sent to the legislative council, so what the legislative council can do, legislative council can reject it, or it can, what you say, keep it to himself, withhold for, here in this case, 3 months, withhold for 3 months, keep it to himself, that is legislative council, that is the legislative council can keep it to itself, withhold for 3 months, and the other one is it can pass. So when the bill is been passed by the legislative council and sent to the legislative assembly and sent to legislative council, the legislative council can reject it, can withhold it, or it can pass the bill, one thing, fine. And then again when it comes back to the legislative assembly, then it is understood that the bill is passed, fine, because it has been agreed by the legislative council, and then again it passes. So when it want, suppose in few scenarios it is passing the bills, but it wanted few amendments. Amendment in the sense, few changes to be done. So in that case, what the assembly will do, legislative assembly will do, it will go ahead with changing. If it wants, it will change the amendments, fine, and then it will again send it back to the legislative council, and again the legislative council will sign it, and then it will go ahead. And then again when it comes back to the legislative assembly, that means the bill has been passed. For example, when the bill is so passed for the second time, when the bill has been passed to the legislative assembly, here the bill is rejected. When the bill is rejected by the council and when there is 1 month lapse, or the bill is passed by the council with amendments, so here in this case the legislative assembly may or may not, these two keywords are very important, it may agree or it may not agree. So it will not, what you say, wait for, or it will not look at the amendments made second time when it is sent, when the bill is sent by the state legislative assembly to the legislative council second time, and when again the bill from the council is been sent with the amendments, Now the second time the legislative assembly will may or may not accept or it does not agree, and then it is deemed, that means it is understood that it has been passed by the both the houses, and then it has been passed. So Article 197, it is in regards to the restriction, power to restrict the bills which have been passed by the state legislative assemblies to the legislative councils, and nothing in this article shall apply to money bill. As I said, money bill which is actually initiated or introduced in the legislative council or Raj Sabha itself, so it cannot go ahead with that. Fine. So Article 200, Article 197 is very very important, and this is the additional information which I have given for the prelims point of view. Fine. Now I'll get into the next one. So the ministry cautions against use of N95 wall mask. So here the ministry is cautioning about the SARS-CoV-2, the virus, because what is the keyword what we will look at is evolving virus. So virus is evolving. Which virus? SARS-CoV-2. Evolving in the sense it is changing its shape. Why? Because it is mutating. So as the mutating means changing, is it is evolving. So the genome sequencing, it keeps on changing. So what the Union Health Ministry has said is that the N95 mask, which is having a valve in the sense which has some kind of, what you say, space. So here if you look at, see, space, you have a space. So what the Union Health Ministry is saying is that usage of the N95 valved respiratory mask is cautioning against the usage of it. Why? Because the Health Ministry says that it has evidence that from the N95 mask there is a possibility that the virus might move out. In which cases? In the cases wherein the person is infected, that is when a person is asymptomatic. When the person is asymptomatic or infected. So whenever the person is infected or asymptomatic, so in that case, when a person is using the N95 valved respiratory mask, so there the chances of virus moving out of the mask and then getting into the air, and probably it would infect others. So the Union Health Ministry has cautioned the usage of the N95 mask after the Director General of Health Sciences has given an alarm against the usage of this mask. Not to everyone. It is only in the case wherein the person is asymptomatic, that means is infected but not showing any symptoms, or the person who is infected. So only in the case of asymptomatic or infected, the N95 mask is not recommended to use. That is what the Health Ministry has cautioned after the Director General of Health Services has given an alarm in regards to usage of the mask. And it is saying that it is always better to use the homemade protective cover, especially which is used by cotton cloth. So look at it, this is the valve in the sense wherein you have small open spaces. So this, from this open spaces, there is a possibility that the virus might move out. And the other one is European Union leaders strike deal to rebuild economy. So what is the keyword here? The keyword here is massive aid package. Massive aid package for what? For rebuilding economy. So the European Union leaders, 27 countries, that is Britain has moved out of European Union on 1st January 2020, Britain has moved out of it because of the Brexit. So European Union now, I'm giving this information, and now the news is the European Union has struck the deal to rebuild economy by coming up with a massive aid package. That is in regards to the COVID-19. That is in regards to the COVID-19 pandemic. So this aid package is for what? Pandemic ravaged economy. So Europe is totally, or Europe's economy is totally shattered in the sense it has been badly hit. So when it has been badly hit because of the COVID-19 pandemic situation, now the European leaders have come together, that they have come up with the massive aid package. They have come up with the aid package for what? To rebuild the economy of the European Union itself. Why? Because of the entire European countries have been badly hit. Most of the European countries have been badly hit. Their economies have been badly hit because of the COVID-19. And this rescue package is how much? 750 billion euros. So when it is converted into billions, it is $858 billion. In regards to the dollars, it is $858 billion. So why? Because they wanted to make sure that the European Union does not get into the economic recession, does not fall into economic recession. So the European Union wants the European countries, or the European Union doesn't again fall into the economic recession. That is why the European leaders have all come together and agreed for a massive aid package. And the massive aid package is 750 billion euros, that is $858 billion. And then what is important is that Italy, France and then Spain have been badly hit by COVID-19. Italy, France and Spain in Europe, in European or European Europe or European Union. These are the countries which have been badly hit because of the COVID-19, and its economy is badly shattered. And that is why they wanted the economic package, that is massive aid package, to rebuild the economy. But there are few other countries, that is Netherlands and Germany also, which were not really interested with this massive aid package. Because even Netherlands, when it is an aid package for the entire European Union, even the Netherlands and Germany, part of European Union, has to contribute to the aid package. So that is what the Netherlands and the Germany were not interested earlier to come up with the massive aid package. But later on, they have agreed for it. And then we have seen the Britain now, as it has left the European Union on the 1st January 2020, now Britain will not be benefited by the aid plan. Instead, Britain has gone ahead with the state borrowings, because of its economy has also, what you say, has been shattered. So the UK, that Britain has gone ahead with state borrowings, which is of £127.9 billion, or $162.5 billion in last three months till June, that is March, April, or April, May, June. In fact, it will not be benefited by the massive aid package of the European leaders, but instead it has gone ahead with the borrowings, which is in turn an expenditure for the Britain. And there is another news which talks about government ready to take more steps for boosting growth. So what is important is that we have to focus on the keyword called as boosting growth. So the finance minister Nirmala Sitharaman have come up with the 20 lakh crore economic stimulus package which has been actually initiated by our Prime Minister Narendra Modi, and later on our Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman has come up with five phases. Nirmala Sitharaman, Finance Ministry, has come forward to support or to boost the economy by various methods. And what the Finance Ministry says that because of the five phases or the 20 lakh crore economic stimulus package, which is almost 10% of the GDP, has impacted the economic revival. That means what was the economic damage during the national lockdown, and now because of the economic stimulus package, economic revival has taken place because of the economic stimulus package. Please do understand the difference. Economic damage at the time of national lockdown, economic revival because of the economic stimulus package of 20 lakh crore rupees, and then which is this 20 lakh crore rupees is equivalent to 10% of GDP, what the government of India is saying it. And Nirmala Sitharaman is saying that because of the 10% of the GDP stimulus package, the agriculture sector is actually improving. Agriculture sector is improving, not only agriculture sector, but the electricity and fuel consumption is actually increasing within interstate and intrastate movement of goods is taking place. So definitely there is economic revival. That is what Nirmala Sitharaman is saying. And Nirmala Sitharaman, Finance Ministry, is also making it very clear that there would be more policy intervention in the near future to revive the economy. Not only the 20 lakh crore, that is 10% of the GDP, which has taken up because of that agriculture sector is increasing or improving, electricity fuel consumption is it has increased, and movement of goods within the state and in regards to the between the states is also increasing, and retail financial transaction is also increasing. So all that is a positive, that is green shoots, that is positiveness in regards to the economic revival. That is what our Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman is mentioning. Not only that, it says that it will definitely go ahead with more of intervention in the future. Why? Because it is assuring, it is giving confidence to the industries that it will take more steps of the economic stimulus package to the industries. So the Finance Ministry is giving confidence or assuring the industries. And when we have looked at, the Finance Ministry has sanctioned a loan of, in regards to the economic stimulus package, to the MSME, that is micro, small and medium enterprises, it has gone ahead with 1,27,582 crore loan. It has gone ahead, the Finance Ministry has come up with giving a loan of 1,27,582 crores for MSME on what? On the emergency credit line guarantee. This is very, very important. This is a scheme. This is very, very important. So the 1,27,582 crore was sanctioned by the Finance Ministry to the MSME sector, that is micro, small and medium enterprises. 1,27,582 crore loans were sanctioned to MSME under emergency credit line guarantee scheme, ECLG scheme. But what is that amount which is actually disbursed is only just 3 lakh crore out of 1,27,582. It is only lakh crores. It is not crore, it is lakh crores. So out of that, only 3 lakh crore is dispersed. Sorry, out of that, it is 77,600. Out of that, 77,613 crore is just dispersed in regards to the emergency credit line guarantee. So what is important is there is a lot to be pumped money into the MSMEs. Why MSME is important? Because it is the MSME, that is the informal sector. Informal sector, there is almost 40% of the GDP is coming from the informal sectors. 40% of the GDP is contributed by the informal sectors or unorganized sectors. That means the employees in the informal sectors or the unorganized sectors, from them the 40% of the GDP, 40% of the contribution to our Indian GDP do take place. That is why the finance ministry is very much focused in regards to the sanctioning of, out of 3 lakh crore, it has sanctioned 1,27,582, and out of 1,27,582, only 77,613 crore is being dispersed. Please do understand, the total is 3 lakh crore under emergency credit line guarantee, but out of that what is being sanctioned is 1,27,582 crore, but what is disbursed, that is which is given, is only 77,613. So this is very very important for the economy. So the question for today is based on yesterday's, but in a different way, which is today's articles, part of today's article I have given this. So India must pay particular attention to relations with countries. India must pay particular attention to relations with countries in its neighborhood. So what is the keyword here is neighborhood. Relations and neighborhood, such as Nepal, Bangladesh and its allies such as Iran and Vietnam. Please do understand, India must pay particular attention to relations with countries with its neighborhood, that is, or such as Nepal, Bangladesh and its allies such as Iran and Vietnam and other countries. Fine, we'll stop. A truly united and resilient India is the best antidote. Antidote means remedy or a cure. A truly united and resilient India is the best antidote. Antidote means remedy or cure to China's attempts to humble India. So definitely China is trying to attempt or to create a shackle India's economy or its relationship with its neighboring countries. But what India has to do is, India has to pay particular attention to relations. It has to build relations. It has to rebuild the relations what it has had earlier with its neighboring countries such as Nepal, Bangladesh and also its allies, that is Iran and Vietnam. Why? Because a truly united and resilient India is the best antidote to China's attempt to humble India. The impact of united India. So when we are united, India will be far greater, than establishing closer links with US or West. Did you understand it? I will repeat it once again. It is linked to yesterday's, but in a different way I have given a question, because this is part of today's article in the newspaper Hindu. That is why I have picked it from that today's Hindu's article, and then I'm saying this. From here, if you look at the impact of united India will be far greater, because India is now going ahead with, or India is agreeing Australia to be part of Malabar exercise. Australia to be part of Malabar exercise, that is India, Japan and US as of. Fine. Not only that, yesterday if you look at, we have also looked at PASEX. What is PASEX? Passage exercise. So passage exercise yesterday is in regards to the Indian Navy versus along with US Navy in Eastern Indian Ocean. In Andaman Nicobar Islands. Fine. So look at this. This is very very important. So based on the PASEX or Malabar exercise, that is what it says. The impact, will stop it till here. I mean, we'll just put a slash till here. We'll break it there. The impact of United India will be far greater. Will be far greater than established close than far greater than established close and links with US or West. So what the article is saying is, rather than just keeping close or having closer links with US or Western countries, it is always very important to build relations with our neighboring countries, that is Nepal, Bangladesh, Iran and Vietnam, that is Southeast Asian countries, so that we can counter, so that India will be united and resilient, and we can counter China's attempts, and we can counter China's attempt is what is the question. So I think you can definitely write this answer. So this is for mains. In regards to, again, how India is taking up, in regards to handle its internal security or threat, national security. So the question is, critically evaluate, and then now we will recapitulate, that is recap. So what we have discussed here, in this case we have discussed in regards to the speaker, the powers of speakers, discretionary powers of speaker, fine. Again, not only that, High Court or Supreme Court intervention. And then President urged to, here we have looked at Article 200 and Article 197. Again, this is important for polity point of view. This again in regards to the polity point of view. Fine. Again, here N95 mask, when we look at, it is in regards to the health. And then European Union, yes, in regards to the European Union massive aid package, again in regards to the way Europe is trying to make sure that it has its aid package so that it can rebuild its economy, again in what you said, global economy. This we have looked at in regards to the global economy, or specifically concentrating on European Union or European Commission or European Commercial Bank. And then here again in regards to the MSME. So here again, economic revival. So the measures taken for the economic revival. So these are all what we have discussed and which are very, very important for prelims point of view also. So I would say a very big thank you to all of you, and also good luck to you. So good luck, I'm sending you good luck vibes. Vibes means atmosphere. That means the good luck atmosphere to you all. And then please do like the video, share the video and subscribe the video. That is in regards to the Advanced Knowledge System, AKS IAS Academy. You can also visit the AKS IAS.com website. You can also download the mobile app. And then you can link to the Telegram, through the Telegram link to AKS IAS Academy. That is t.me/AKS IAS. And you can also get connected to me personally, that is t.me/SandeepBhushanSBT, t.me/Sandeep, SBT. And then see you tomorrow again at 7:30 a.m. And then please do maintain consistency, stick to your schedule, and then take care of your health, that is physical health and mental health. And today's topic, if you look at, we have looked at it almost exclusively in regards to the polity point of view. Articles we have looked at, the speakers, High Court, and then Article 200, Article 197. So, thank you, and then good luck to you. See you tomorrow at 7:30 a.m. Oh, Gopinayak says, Gopinayak says it's a more role of, yes. It's able to build the Indian economy. Absolutely. It plays a larger role. That is what I said. Informal sectors and formal sectors. Oh, Mastermind says that, okay, you can also, in regards to any queries, you can WhatsApp to my number. You can, my WhatsApp number is 9292003111. You can WhatsApp to my number 9292003111. This is my WhatsApp number. For any queries in regards to the subject, any doubts or suggestions in regards to preparation or in regards to the subject, please do WhatsApp to my number 9292003111. Fine. So I would say thank you, and then see you tomorrow at 7:30 a.m. And then I would say a very big thank you to everyone.